Good morning, friends. And we start, as usual, with the normal intro. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened is the blessed Buddha. This Dhamma talk is the second in a series which could be called Back to Basics. Last time I talked a little bit about producing peace by training the rule, the first Buddhist behavioral rule of not killing. This obviously produced peace in here and out there in society. Otherwise, if you kill, there'll be a lot of conflict in here and out of society. The first precept, just to brush up, is basically laid down because it's impossible to kill another being without killing yourself also, in the sense that your future life length becomes shorter. The probability for you being hit by accident or disease becomes bigger. So the life length becomes shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter for each killing. Therefore, one should not kill. You can say purely out of egoistical reasons, because one is clipping off with a salami tactic one's own future life, little by little. In the same way, in the same sense, you can say, is the second precept, which says that one should not take what is not given freely to you specifically. Why not, actually? Why cannot one steal? If one keeps it secret, it's not secret for nature, and it's not secret for one's own mind, whatever one does. So there's no secrecy there. In the same way with killing, one increases one's future probability of being poor. The normal rationale of stealing something, or cheating, or fraud, make fraud with some kind of thing, assurance fraud, for example, writing wrong numbers on a bill, or so on, reporting the wrong numbers to some authority that pays you back, for example, taxation, and so on. It's all kinds of stealing. We don't call it stealing, but in the Buddhist sense, and from the sense of nature, it is stealing, because one is deliberately misappropriating value to oneself that didn't actually belong to oneself. This has the effect, creating a probability wave, quantum mechanical probability wave, that is everywhere, and then one will meet the echo of everywhere, wherever one go. In one's future time, one will have bad luck in business. One will have, if one have to will buy something, it's a higher price if one have not stolen it, stolen something in one's past. All things that makes one more poor, the probability for these events goes up. And all events that makes one more rich, more wealthy, the probability for these events occurring goes down. Then it's impossible not to be more poor in the future if you steal something, than the opposite event, if you give something, then you become more rich. The normal conventional rationale or logic, which only goes on the short run, is that if you steal something, you become more rich, you gain some value. That's also true on the very short run, but in the long run, you become more poor. On the other hand, vice versa, if you give something, the normal conventional rationale is that you become more poor, therefore you should not give something. But actually, because the probability goes up for you becoming wealthy, on the long run, one becomes more rich by giving something, on the long run. Secondly, the effect of one's happiness is the same. One thinks, if I steal something, then I become more happy because I become more rich. But that maybe also occur after 5 minutes. But already the next day, or the next month, or the next year, one will have regrets and remorse, and therefore feel unhappy. One will look back and say, I did something evil. I did something wrong. I did something detestable. I stole from another being. This goes whether you steal from another being, or from an institution, or from a state. People say, usually, you can steal from the state. It doesn't matter, because the state is so rich, and they are so unfair. But that's no argument for stealing. Or stealing from the rich, or you can steal from them because they have have enough, so they don't feel the theft so much. That doesn't count. That's their business. It's one's own business that counts in the future. Actually, you can say stealing from the state by taxation fraud, or stealing from an insurance company by assurance fraud, is, I think, maybe even more detestable than stealing from a person, because it's like, for example, you've been made secretary from a sport club, which has some kind of common bank account or something. Then you take from this common good, this pool of common good. This also goes from the state. You take from a pool of common good. This money that you take when you don't pay your tax, or when you cheat the insurance company, they are taken from somebody else. Huh? Because they have to come in. They have to be built roads, bridges, hospitals, whatever. There has to be paid out assurance to those who are in accidents. So this is a very bad excuse for making fraud. Also with traveling expenses, one have been funded by some organization, public or private, and then one overbill the expenses and thereby cash in some amounts on the excuse that it was travel expenses, but it was not travel expenses at all. It was for one's private use. Whether it actually is discovered by others or not doesn't matter. The effect of one's future, both regarding wealth going down and happiness going down, this is parked out in nature, and it's parked in mind, and it's deposited in the heart. It is everywhere. One cannot run away from it. So you can say, from a purely egoistical point of view, one should not steal because, inevitably, it always makes one unhappy and too poor. The probability of one becomes poor goes up in the future, and the probability of one becoming rich goes down. This can be very significant over a long time if it's accumulated many times, that one embezzles something or misappropriates some value. Whether it's money or things or whatever that can be stolen or misappropriated, one does it deliberately, knowing that it's another person's value or another institution's value that one is misappropriating. It is there this intention is formed to take it. It is right there the karmic accumulation that is very negative. It is actually created. It is not created by stealing the thing itself. It is created in mind, by mind. and propagate it out everywhere as a wave of probability that cannot be erased again. This rule of not stealing, one can find in all religions. It's not only the second precept in Buddhism, you can also find it in the Ten Commandments, in Christianity, you can find it in the Muslim faith, you can find it in the Hindu faith, you can find it in all nature religions. Needless to say, if when beings start to steal from each other, it will create disharmony in the society. So not only does it create individual unhappiness, it also creates, on a slowly accumulating level, social disharmony, eventually leading to conflict, war, revolution, and such things that often is violent. One will usually say, ah, I can't take a little, doesn't matter, doesn't matter. Yes, it does matter. Because if one say it doesn't matter, then one will do it again and again and again. And over a long life, one will have accumulated a lot of embezzlement, a lot of theft. One can repair this karmic effect again with delivering back what one has stolen, if possible, to either the person, if there is a person, if one knows the person, and then ask for forgiveness, admit it to the person, or to the institution, whether it's a state or something. Or one can give a similar, or even better, a greater amount to the same institution as a donation, or to the same person as a donation. So thereby repairing the karmic effect. If one delivers back to a specific person something one has stolen and asks for forgiveness, and he gives forgiveness, then the karmic accumulation is zero. Then one goes scot-free regarding that particular theft. Then it's repaired. There's a non-linear effect between the theft and the effect of the theft regarding who you steal from. So if you steal from a dog, let's say you steal a lump of food from a dog, how much is the effect? Yeah, in rough numbers, 1,000 times you will lose the lump of food, 1,000 lumps of food over some lifetimes from stealing from a dog. So it's 1,000 times 100%. So it means from a business point of view, it is extremely bad business. You don't need to be an accountant to understand that. You lose 1,000 times minimum what you gain by stealing. You gain initially, but then you'll use 1,000 times more. This is what you steal from a dog. If you steal it from a thief who also steals, then it's 1,000 times 1,000. It's 1,000,000. If you steal it from one who gives, who doesn't steal, a pure person regarding this giving and stealing thing, aspect, then it's 1,000,000 times 1,000,000. This 1,000,000,000,000 times. You steal amount $1, but the accumulated karmic effect is that you're gonna lose $1,000,000,000,000 over many lifetimes before the effect, the probability effect, is exhausted. That's very, very bad business. If you steal it from a noble, we say it's incalculable. Asankhya, it cannot be calculated. If you steal it from a Buddha, it will take many universes before one will come back to zero. And since one cannot identify who's noble or not, who's pure or not, one can only formulate this one rule of thumb, not to steal at all. Whether it's from a dog, from a thief, from a pure person, or from a noble, one should not steal at all. This is the only safe, simple rule one can formulate from that thing. But one can do very, very bad by stealing from the wrong person. Adinadana is a saying in Pali. It simply means to take what is not given. If an institution or a person gives you something, it's gifts like a gift or a personal gift, you can use it for anything, then it's okay. But if it's given for this purpose, then you use it for that purpose. It's given for research, then one use it. Or for charity, then one use it for private consumption of whatever. Then we are into the gray area between stealing and cheating. The opposite of stealing is, of course, giving. This has the opposite effect of stealing, since the probability of getting richer over time, not only in this life, but also in the future lives to come, it goes up. Again, it's the same. If you give to the dog a lump of food, you'll get that lump of food back 1,000 times in this life or in future lives before the karmic effect is exhausted. If you give it to a noble, you cannot, it's uncountable. If you give it to a Buddha, it will last many universal cycles of future lifetimes. One should give with a good heart. That's a story from the ancient text, the Tipitaka text, about this. It's a man who'd been very rich and has given, but he was not satisfied with the giving. And the story goes like this. Bimbisara, he comes to King Bimbisara, was Buddha's good friend. They had the same age. He comes one afternoon to the Buddha and visit him. And then say, the Buddha asks him, why do you come, King Bimbisara, here in the afternoon? The king answers, said he'd been taking out gold and silver, gold for 7 days and silver for 7 days, out of a treasury of a personal banker inside the city, because this banker had no family. And then the rule was at that time, then the wealth goes to the king, so he can use it on the army and so on, use it on the city. And he came to ask a question about that, because they told him about this man, which now was dead, that he never enjoyed anything. He wore rag robes, and he eat broken rice, and he had a ramshackle cart, and his house was dilapidated. He never used any money, neither on himself nor on anybody else. And he was not very happy about his own situation. And this was very strange, because he was exorbitantly rich, money-wise. So King Bimbisara came to the Buddha and asked him, why was that so? And the Buddha looked back in this particular individual's past, and then he said, I will explain to you, King Bimbisara. This man, he was one a seti. This was this kind of a millionaire, which was usually also a private kind of private banker at the Buddha's time. And then one day he went to the king, then he saw a particular Buddha, private Buddha. And then he asked him, he was coming in his horse cart there, have you got any food today, Venerable? No, the particular Buddha answered. Then go to my house and say to the servants, you can get my food, my lunch. And then he went to the king, and the particular Buddha, he went there and got the food and went back to the forest. Then on the road there, he saw the king, or the millionaire, coming back from the king, and then he asked, did you get the food? Yes, he got the food. But then the millionaire saw he wasn't shaved. Pasika Buddha, they don't shave. They have hair 2 fingerspread long, and also a beard 2 fingerspread long, and they have very rough clothes. So he was saying, this dirty monk, I shouldn't have given it to him. He was dissatisfied with his giving. But nevertheless, he had given it. He had already given it. Because he made the afterthought second karma, connected with his first karma, he made this bad. He regretted his giving. He wants to have it back, that he should have eaten it himself, this food, or given it to his waiters, or to his family, his wife and children. They should have had enjoyed this food meant for him. He should not have given it to this dirty monk, which was fully enlightened. Because of that, he would have told, for seven times, he was a billionaire in this very town where he had given. But he never enjoyed any of his riches. Never. They have all stayed locked in his rooms in gold and silver. He never used it, neither on himself nor of others. And he was never happy about his riches. And now he had exhausted this karma, this seven times lifetime lasting karma. So he will go to the fall down, we say. He will go to a lower level than human, be reborn as a lower level than human. This illustrates this karmic effect, how long lasting it is, whether you give something or you steal something. There's a good rule about private economy in Buddhism, if we talk about giving and spending in general. I think also it's worth noticing that from a Buddhist point of view, it is not morally bad or evil or wrong in any way to be rich or wealthy. Not at all. Actually, it's a sign, like this rich man, that you have been giving or been generous in the past life, long ago, to somebody who are worthy of it, or to many who are needy. Because I have practiced this generosity, people are now rich. But as also said in the Bible, this one experienced very often as monk, when you go begging with your bowl, rich people, for some reason, maybe because they become more greedy by being rich, has a tendency not to give. When you go by your begging bowl, you go barefoot begging, it is the typical experience is if you go in a poor area in a town, you'll get a lot. If you go in a rich area in a town, you get almost nothing, if you get anything at all, even though they see you coming. So this is very strange. This will have the karmic effect of, as I said in the Bible, the first will come last and the last will come first. The rich will be poor and the poor will be rich. So it's kind of like oscillating between rich and poor if one stay at the human level. Here, locally where I live, there's a lot of reasonably poor people. They have become poor because of prior stealing. And this they also do today. This I've seen many times. They will typically steal the cardamom, a spice which has considerable value here. 1 kilo is the same, can be sold for the same as one day hire. So they steal the cardamom from the plantations here. And this means, of course, that they will be poor again in the future. They think they become more rich. They think it's kind of like Robin Hood stealing, because they are stealing from somebody they perceive as rich. The plantation owner, which in many cases is a state, but can also be private. But that's not the case. The future, nature, doesn't care who you steal from. It only cares about the stealing. This one often sees through karmic history that people repeat good habits and also bad habits. Habitual behavior over a long time that then will make an oscillation in the karmic history in samsara. Returning to Buddhist economy, we'll say if one has some income, how should one use it? How should one spend it in order to get the best outcome? One should use 1/5 on oneself, on one's own enjoyment, personal enjoyment. That's the purpose of getting wealth in the first place. It is to have some joy, some happiness from this richness one have earned by the sweat of one's own brow. There's nothing immoral or egoistic in using money on yourself, as long as it's money that is earned honestly and earnestly by the sweat of your own brow. Then it's okay. Then one should use 1/5 on the household, family, wife, children, guests and so on. The 1/3 one should invest in one's business. So there's a growth of one's business in the future. The 4/5 one should put in the bank as a safeguard toward bad times in the future. And the final 1/5 one should give to those worthy of it, and those who need it, those who are poor. Today everybody have a bank account. I don't have a bank account. But nevertheless, people have a bank account. They maybe have more than one bank account. But let's just say we can pool it in one bank account. And they can be plus or minus. This is very tangible and visible. You'll get a letter from their bank every month, or you can see it on the internet how much is on your bank account. And people are very, very conscious about that. A lot of speculation and unhappiness is about how much is on the bank account, whether it's above zero or below zero. What people do not generally understand is that there's another account that also contains an accumulation. An accumulation of what? An accumulation of future. An accumulation of probability for either being happy or being unhappy, of either being rich or being poor, of either being beautiful or being ugly, and so forth. Regarding all possible states that can't be attained in the future, there is an accumulation, a karmic accumulation, that contains probabilities for these or that events to occur or not. This can be demonstrated in a laboratory. This is a fact, an experimental fact. This means because we cannot see this account, because we have no feedback from this account, people will say, ah, this account doesn't exist, it's not real. And therefore, they don't fear their karmic account going down as much as their bank account going down. But that's really foolish. Because let's say you steal something and you put it in the bank and your bank account go up, yes, but your karmic account go down. And vice versa, if you give something, you take some money out of the bank and you give it to some poor or some worthy people, then your bank account go down, but your karmic account go up. The 1/5 rule assures that your bank account goes up, both now and later. It also assures, because of the giving, both to your own household and family, and also to those poor, and also to those worthy, that your karmic account also goes up. So it's a win-win situation. Stealing is a lose-lose situation, because on the long run, it will lead to loss, much greater loss than is initially gained. I know these rules of life, these precepts and general talk about morality and ethics is not popular today, but since they are so important, crucially important for society in general, for the harmony in society in general, and for everyone's personal welfare, I think they are worth mentioning. That we should really not throw out the baby with the bathwater, what we have got from our ancestors regarding rules of thumb of how to live, what to do and what not to do. This we should preserve, because they are not a prison. Morality is not a prison. It's an umbrella that protects you from bad events raining down on you in the future, unhappiness raining down on you in the future. Therefore, these back to basics rules has to be respected, has to be understood, not from a disciplinarian point of view, but from a point of view of elevating one's own future. And thereby also, if everybody does that, the future of a whole society and the happiness that is in that society, the harmony that is in that society. Thank you for your attention.